Okay, and it looks like we've confirmed that we are being recorded. So again, afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining. Thanks for taking some time out of your busy schedule. And welcome. Welcome to the BASF Perimeter Pro webinar. My name is Scott Etheridge. I am one of our product managers on the marketing team for BASF. I manage the Trilona and also the Termidor product lines. And so I want to welcome you, and I'm really excited. Today we are talking ant control, which we all know is one of our biggest revenue drivers for PMPs, but also can be a significant source of callbacks if not treated appropriately. So thankfully we have an expert here, Dr. Fred Medina, who I will introduce in a second, who's gonna walk you through a really great presentation with a lot of educational tools, best practices, et cetera, to help you in those battles out in the field. So one thing I did want to note, as we said earlier, we are recording. I also wanted to let you know that as a bonus and as a thank you, we're excited to say we're going to have a random drawing. So there's three prizes. One of those is a backpack sprayer. The other two are Yeti. They're actually half gallon jugs. And we're going to do a random drawing as a thank you for joining today. So stay tuned for more on that. If we could go to the next slide, I will introduce our speaker.
Okay, there you go.
All right, thank you. So so Dr. Fred Medina, again, is going to lead us through the presentation today. I wanted to give you a little bit of background information. Dr. Fred, he began his first entomology project back in 1990. He also received his Bachelor's of Science in Ag Engineering in 1996. Fredder's got a lot of tremendous experience in the field. He's been a licensed PMP since 1997, where he worked with ABC Pest. He received his doctorate in entomology in 2010 from Texas A&M. And then he went on to be the regional tech director for Home Team Pest before joining BASF in the tech service and now our tech marketing team. So again, Dr. Fredder's an expert in all things pest, specifically ant control for today. He's gonna provide a lot of good information. If you can go to the next slide, please. So now that we've introduced our speaker, I wanted to give you just a quick reminder of, you know, what is Perimeter Pro? You've probably heard BASF talking about this quite a bit. And really, it's a playbook that gives you three keys to the game. The first, as always, we start with a strong IPM strategy. So, you know, think about inspections, exclusions, conducive conditions, everything you need to do before you get to those certain types of control. And of course, today we'll talk a lot about chemical control, but also what can you do physically and mechanically as well. Next, you have your right product rotation. So this can be based on seasonality, rotating modes of action, frequency, et cetera. And then after you have that starting rotation, we call this our bullpen of trusted specialists that you want to have built up. You want to have a strong portfolio. Really, as you're troubleshooting issues, you want to have those easy to use, reliable products and have a lot of different tools in the toolbox. So if we can go to the next slide, I wanted to just give you a kind of a view of what the lineup looks like, at least from a BASF perspective. And so I'll start by saying the items that you see here in bold, those are some products that Fred is going to talk about today as part of the training, simply because of their ant control properties. And so you'll notice a few of these familiar products. And starting on the dilutable side is Termidor SC. So this is really our foundational product for perimeter control. We also have Alpine WSG, which is a really flexible solution that has a lot of key pests on the label as well as application sites. And then Findona, which is our long-lasting broad-spectrum perimeter treatment. In our bullpen, we have a couple of foam formulations, including Termidor and Alpine foam. A lot of great pressurized products, so including Findona, Phantom, and Alpine. And even a new product that's coming in our pipeline, PT Vidira. And so much more to come there in the future, but just a little teaser there of our upcoming solutions. We also have a lot of great ant bait, so Advance, Mother Earth, Siesta, and again, another product coming in the pipeline, as well as dust solutions. So you'll see in the middle here, there's a lot of considerations on when you're applying, where, et cetera. But really, you wanna have these tools ready to go and know how to apply them properly and safely. The last item I'll say here is this is a great timing for this webinar because our spring promotion just kicked off at the beginning of April and will run until the 29th. And several of the products that are listed here, including Termidor, Findona, and our advanced baits are actually on that promotion. So after the webinar wraps up, feel free to get with your distribution partner and talk about how you can save some money on these products and try them out in the field using Dr. Fretter's training. So the last slide that I'm going to get to here is just a bit of housekeeping. We definitely want to hear your questions, comments, feedback, et cetera. And so you'll notice if you're familiar with Zoom, there is a Q&A box. Please click on that, put your question in as you think of it, and then we are going to answer those sections at the end of the webinar. And so I just wanted to point out that functionality so that everyone feels comfortable and knows how to ask their questions so that we can answer them as we wrap up. So with that, if we can go to the next slide, I'm going to hand it off to Dr. Fretter Medina, who is going to now start his portion of the Ant Control Perimeter Plus presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott, for the introduction. And one of the things is I'm super excited to be here, be able to present on this topic because I spent a lot of years of my life specifically working with ants in Texas. And yeah, I'm super excited to show you some ideas on what you could do and how you can take control, reduce those callbacks that that are very important for our business and to grow our business, right? So one of the things I do want to point out is that ants are still number one revenue generator when you look at all the past year after year, and callbacks are on average about between six and 7% for ant control. What is most interesting is that PMPs, when you look at the what products they use around perimeter of the structure, they rely heavily on pyrethroids. And when you look at those products, actually 15 out of those products commonly used around structures today, only two of those are non-pyrethroids, and three of those are combo products that contain at least one pyrethroid. So again, you're going to see today why it is important to choose the right product for successful control. Ants, we all know they're not easy to control. There's many variables at play. And most importantly, I'm going to show you some of the behavioral components of ants specifically that might help you deal with some of the problems you're having, some of the accounts you're having in the field. So what tools are available to us? There's a lot of tools too, and we're going to try to cover some of those. The end goal here is, again, to reduce callbacks and successfully being able to control ants in general. So with that being said, one of the things I want to point out about ants is they belong to the order Hymenoptera. You're going to find bees and wasps in this order too. But what is interesting about this group is the most advanced insect order. And they've been around for a long, long time. So every time you have something that had the chance to evolve throughout millions of years, and they had the opportunity to really adapt to different environmental conditions. And that's important. You're going to see that today here, hopefully in this presentation. They're all associated, or the vast majority of the species we deal with, they're associated with humans and homes and their environment, able to use different defense mechanisms. We'll talk about some of those as well. They're protected inside their colony. Now, when I say colony, there's a lot of variability about how they live. Some may have colonies that go several feet in the ground, where others, they can live on a potted plant, and it could be under the rock. Some of those actually forms colonies on the rugs in a room inside a home. So there's a lot of variability when it comes to the type of colony they form. Some of you are familiar with the fire ants. They form those big, large mounds. So the whole idea is the colony should be protected, and they feel protected not only from predators, but also the environment in these colonies. Some of these colonies can have single or multiple queens. I've seen like super colonies could have up to hundreds of queens in the case of, for example, Argentine ants and other large super colonies. But like fire ants, the most I've seen on fire ants is about 30 queens in a single colony. They're capable of high dispersion rate, either by budding or by their mating flights. And this is something that happens in nature. Now, when we're using repellent products like pyrethroids, you have to keep in mind that budding becomes a way of spreading and creating a bigger problem from when you started within that particular home or structure. So keep those things in mind when you're dealing with ants. Again, like I mentioned, they're well adapted to different environmental conditions. And one of the things I do want to show is these fire ant raft. When there's floodings and these colonies get flooded, the whole colony rises with the water. And matter of fact, the ants that are under the water, they rotate with the other ants so they don't drown. Also within that raft, you're going to have the queen or queens. You're going to have a lot of immature stages, like a lot of pupa, a lot of fourth instar larva. And those are first picked up by the colony to them with the chances of, or increasing the chances of surviving. And those are mechanisms they have learned throughout time. Last but not least, these are eusocial insects. And it's something I do want to point out in my next slide, what eusocial insects are. This comes from the Greek eu, meaning good or real social insects, like ants, bees, wasps, and termites. And what do they have all in common? They have all these in common. Their highest level of organization, the whole colony form functions as an organism. They have cooperative care of the brood, the young. Remember, brood is the young in the colony. They have overlapping generations. They have caste differentiations and division of labor. I do want to point out one thing is ants, all ants in the colony, when I said ants in general, the workers have the capability of doing different functions. Although their function, they have specific tasks like nurses, like protecting, like rebuilding the colony and things like that, they're all equally capable of doing all of those, but they do specialize in some of those tasks. Now, when we look at invasive ants, specifically what we call the tramp ants, one thing I do want to point out is not all exotic ants are tramp species, but tramp species, for the most part, they have these features. They form large colonies. A good example is Argentine ants in California. There's a huge, you know, super colony. It takes up all the entire state, and there's a lot of research being done on that. They're also very aggressive, and they're aggressive towards other species, but not their own. They have budding capabilities, meaning that they can disperse by budding, and that allows them to invade new areas. They're easily moved by humans. And again, they can live in a potted plant, they can live under a rug or in a container. I've seen some of those even in mailboxes. So they're easily moved by humans. They're opportunistic. They have very flexible nesting habits. We just talked about it. They're omnivores, meaning that they feed on pretty much anything they can get. They can get to it, usually carbohydrate, proteins, and lipids, but they can pretty much eat anything out there. They have overlapping biology with many of the native species, and they have the capabilities of actually reducing native species, their diversity and abundance. Some are very ecological and disrupted ants, you know, tawny crazy ants and species like that have the ability to disrupt whole ecosystems, same with fire ants and other species too. They tend to dominate limiting factors like water, food, like nesting sites, harbor areas, and they occupy a niche in nature. By the way, when that niche is, they move or they die, that colony, usually somebody else, another colony, have the ability to move in and occupy that niche, that empty niche. So that's why it's important to keep on going with our control strategies. Even when we don't have ants, we have to be in the lookout for those. One thing I do want to say also is that the effects of certain species are well known. For example, the effects of fire ants on their stinging capabilities, as you see in this picture. And some of you have seen some of these pictures of, you know, they can lead to death. Humans, you know, cause allergic, severe allergic reactions. Bird, cattle, fish, all these can be affected by fire ants and other species too. Some of you, I don't know if you've seen these pictures, been circulating for many, many years now. What is important to note, and I don't know if you can see my cursor, but down on the arm of the lady here, you can see a row of pustules. And what fire ants are known for is as they walk, they start stinging with their abdomen and they create that perfect line of postures. But they also do what you see in this picture on the left, where they grab your skin or the person's skin and start stinging in a circle. And that's exactly what you see down below the line. You see a perfect circle with one ant probably cause all those stinging points or pustules there. There's also other ways ants can be annoying. And it's not only the stinging part. In this case, this is an example I want to share with you. This happened in Phoenix many years ago. I went to a customer's house and the lady was complaining about ants in the bathroom. And when I looked at the ants, I said, oh, these are harvester ants. What are they doing here? Where are they coming from? We couldn't figure it out until we found a little gap and they were coming through the wall. When we took that panel, we actually had to cut an axis to get in there. We noticed the plumbing penetration and I had to use a mirror, as you see in the right side here, where that little tiny hole, that's where the entire colony was. This was a brand new house that happened to be built on top of the colony. They had to come out a certain place. One thing I do want to say about this experience is that every account is unique. Every situation is different. In this case, I decided to put like a little bowl, you can see there with some bait, a granular bait. I'm not going to say the name there, but we put the bowl in there and we wanted to wait a few days to come back and see. My plan with this is to be able to kind of measure how much they were consuming. If I scattered these in the wall, I had no idea how much they were consuming. I have to tell you, like 4 days later, we came back, we opened up the wall again. I mean, we just held it with blue tape. And by the time we came back, we opened it up again. There were like a few dead ants. There were no more ants around the house to be seen. And actually this bowl was almost gone, almost empty. So again, depending on the colony size, depending on the species, depending on what you're trying to accomplish, you may need to go back at least a couple more times to revisit and follow up with that homeowner and see what's going on. And this is a good example of that. So these are just as examples of how these can be annoying, but in how they can affect our customers and how we do our services. Now, one thing I do want to mention, I'm going to spend a little bit more time about it, the colony, their behavior. I'm going to use fire ants as an example because these are the pictures I had when I worked with ants in the past. But what's more important is for you to be able to understand the behavioral, their behavior, and most importantly, their feeding behavior inside the colony, because that has an outcome on baiting, on control methods that you're going to be using later. So when you look at any ant colony, usually when I'm in person, I would ask the audience, so if you have the ability to shrink and go inside an ant colony, what members do you see? What do you see inside the colony? And for the most part, I get this answer, the queen or queens, could be multiple queens as we learn. There's going to be also workers in there. Now, one thing I do want to point out is in this picture, you can see the polymorphism in these workers, meaning they're different size workers. Some ant species are monomorphic, meaning they're all the same size. So it's important when you talk to the homeowner, you can ask these questions. Are they all sizes? Are they one color or two colors? And this will give you ideas, depending on the region of the country you're in, which species you might be dealing with. Also inside the colony, you have the alates, and these are males and females alates. These are the ones that are gonna go into the nuptial flights and they're gonna mate and form new colonies, another way of dispersing their species. But also there's more. Inside the colony, the queen lays eggs. So the eggs hatch into the first, second, and third instalarva, then becomes into the fourth instalarva, go through a prepupal stage. It's not a stage actually, it's a phase. Prepupal phase to then go to the pupal stage, which then hatches into the adult. One thing I do want to point out is that from instar 1 through 3, these youngsters, they feed all the time. So think about, you know, these little kids, they feed all the time. They never go to the bathroom until they become a fourth instar larvae, where they increase their consumption of all the food. Most importantly, they increase the consumption of solid food. In the first, second, and third, for the most part, they will always ingest liquids. And the fourth instar larva is the one that starts digesting some of the solid foods. And this is very important. That's why they get bigger and they grow fast. The fourth instar larva is like the teenager in your family. They're always eating, they're always hungry. And for obvious reason, because they need to get ready for what's coming next. And what happens is towards the end of their development, they release what is called the meconium. The meconium is the first poop. And I put it this way, nice words. What happens is they clean all their gut content. As you can see on the pre-pupa, there's nothing inside their gut. It looks clear and white, but you can definitely see all the food that have been accumulating for quite some time on the fourth instar larva. So what happens is that is an important step in the process. I'm gonna show you some pictures now of what a real larva looks like. This is a picture, by the way, the previous picture was a real picture, but this is a close-up using scanning electron microscopy. And one of the things I wanna point out, there's no legs on these larva. There you can see the head. You can see the head down here. There's no legs. They're pretty hairy. And I'm going to get to that in a second because this is very important. Even the hairs are really important. They play a very important role. This is what a fourth instar, fully grown instar, fourth instar larva looks like. And then if we go back here, we talk about releasing that meconium. Let's take a closer look at that meconium. Again, the fourth instar larvae. And you can see here the meconium that is started to come out. Now, one thing I want to mention is about all these hairs. If I'm in a room and I ask the question, what do you see with these hairs? I usually get the answer first from any ladies in the room, splitted end hairs. And what is interesting is that the ants had evolved to develop these hair structures that when you put two larvae together, they actually hooked, and it's almost like Velcro. So these guys knew Velcro way before humans. And what allows the ants to do, as you know, ants are very strong. So ants now, by hooking all these bunch of larvae, they can carry 15, 10, 20, whatever number of larvae they can carry on top of their heads, and it's easy to move them that way. So there's, again, proof of adaptations that they had to go through and proof that they're well adapted to actually move their young, move colonies, move houses from one place to the next. So it's a common thing they do. It's a normal part of their behavior. So if we go back now, the meconium is released. The pre-pupa, again, it's not a stage, it's a phase, it's clean. It's getting ready now to form the pupa. And this is the pupa, what a pupa looks like. You can actually see it's X-ray type of pupa. You can see the antenna, you can see the eyes, you can see the legs. You can even count the two nodes. And then once they complete, they get to the end of the pupal stage is when they become an adult. And of course, I have to show you the picture of the adult as well. Two things I want to mention here. Look at the size of these, 2 millimeters. So imagine a PMP, one of you going outside and looking at 2 millimeter, almost a 4 millimeter ant in the field. One thing is that if you're an entomologist, you know that you have to count the nodes, you have to count the segments of the club of the antenna and the segments of the antenna themselves. And by looking at these features, now I can tell you we're dealing with a fire ant. Now I said fire ant because I don't know if it's a red imported fire ant yet, or it could be a native ant species, or, you know, could be the black imported fire ant, could be something else. So, but based on these features already, I can tell this is a fire ant, and we'll get to that in a second in a different picture that I'll show you. The stinger is hidden back here. I couldn't get a good picture of the stinger as they curl up when they die. But one important feature I do want to mention is these holes here are called spiracles. These are the nose of the ants. This is how they breathe. Through the side of their body on both sides, they're going to have the spiracles. So this is pretty interesting features that you can see up close when you take these scanning electron microscopy images. Now let's talk about the feeding behavior. You're going to see in a moment, if you stay with me, you're going to see why I'm spending all this time on these and going through all these details. It's super important. And once you learn this, I think you'll never forget again how baiting takes place with ants. And it will be really, I hope, really cool that you can learn some of these things. I want to mention when liquid food is picked up by the workers, it could be from the kitchen counter, it could be from the backyard, it could be from the pet's bowl that food got left out with oils and things like that. All the liquids are picked up by the workers. And they do what is called trophallaxis. They transfer the content, their gut content, and they share it and actually until it reaches the colony. Once it's inside the colony, they will go and feed the first, second, and third insta larva with these liquid type of food. But also they have the ability to pick up solids. This could be your bait, could be your granular bait that you lay down in the yard. It could be the granular bait that you put somewhere in the house, but this will be all the solids. It could be a piece of cricket, a piece of, you know, a cockroach leg, anything like that. So what they do is, for the most part, they bring it into the colony. They will try to chop it into smaller pieces if they can, but if they cannot, they will bring the whole piece inside the colony. And what they do is they go straight to the fourth insta larva. And this is very important what I'm about to say, because these teenagers in the colony, remember, they eat a lot. They need a lot of food. They need a lot of proteins. And what they do is they take that food and digest all the solid food, which is then transformed into liquid and is fed directly to the queen or queens, but also fed to the first, second, and third insta larvae. One thing I do want to mention, and we didn't touch on the meconium yet, but the meconium has a liquid and a solid component. The liquid part is actually fed to the queen and is being known to increase egg production. So there's a high nutritional value on that liquid component of the meconium. And then the solid part is recycled to the teenager. Remember that guy that eats a lot. And that guy actually digests all the solid components and the whole cycle repeats itself. So that's how food moves inside a fire ant colony. Again, I'm using fire ants as an example because I got all these cool pictures. But you get the idea of how fast or slow this process can be. And of course, depending on the species, depending on their behavior, depending on the size of the colony, this happens at different speeds and different rates, which brings my next point, that if we're dealing with products that are repellents and products that kill fast, do you think you're going to get to the queen or queens? Chances are you're going to kill a lot of workers, but you will never get to the queen or queens. And that's important to mention. Now that we've seen all this, let me show you actually a video of ants doing trophallaxis. And this is some of the ways they actually transfer a little dose. If an ant picks up a product and then by doing trophallaxis, transfer a little dose to the next ant. You can see here the smaller ant feeding the larger ant. Remember, these are polymorphics. If polymorphism, you can definitely see it here. And that's one way when you use non-repellent products with transfer effect, this is one way it passes from one ant to the next. By contact, antenation, they do also necrophoresis and all that. And that's, we must take advantage of all that. And remember those 15 products, and only two of those were non-repellents and non-parathroids. So think along those lines and double check and see what you guys are using today and if it is the best strategy. We're going to learn at the end of this talk I hope you can stay all the way to the end, because I'm sharing with you some really cool ideas for putting together a nice protocol for ant control. We talk about that teenager. I keep bringing this up because this is the best analogy. These guys sit there all day watching TV. No, just kidding. They don't have TVs, but you know, they sit there all day and they eat. They eat, and that's all they do all day. They have this depression in their chest. It's called precipium. That's where the worker ants take the food and they put it on their chest. As you can see, some chunks of food are left behind in this picture. Now, the larva tilts their head and they regurgitate saliva and extraorally digest all those solids and convert those solids to liquids. And that's exactly what the processing of all the food takes place in the colony. And from that point on, other nurses, other ants, worker ants, pick it up the liquid form now and take it to the queen. What is important to mention is when you look at the anatomy of the adults, and by the way, this is a close-up picture of their face. You can see actually their mandible. You can see the left mandible and the right mandible. And by the way, to tell some species apart, you even have to count the number of teeth. If you have three, it's one species. If you have four, it's a different species. There's no way you can see any of these in the field, by the way. But just wanted to point that out, that it's not only the antennal segments and other things. It could be hairs. It could be teeth, counting up to the number of teeth. What you see here is their mouth cavity. And what you see here is where the granular bait could be, solid food. And what happens is the workers cannot digest, they cannot ingest actually the solid food. Again, this is done by the 14 star larva. What happens is when you slice, and this is a slice right in half of the ant head, what you see here is the mouth entrance. I don't know if you can see my cursor. I hope you're doing it. You're seeing it. And then it actually bends this way. And it bends again this other way here. There's a lot of bends until it reaches the pharynx. And then it goes down on the esophagus. Now, one thing I want to point out, there's an infrabuccal pocket here that is labeled here, infrabuccal pocket. That acts as, you know, all the solids, when they take all those solids, they fall into the infrabuccal pocket, smaller particles and things like that. That solid food cannot pass through all these tiny, small, tight bends. It's almost like a cow, it's like the rumen of a cow. You know, they're eating grass all the time and all that gets stored in the rumen. This is kind of similar analogy to that. And what happens is the liquids are able to pass through all these bends, but not the solids. And what happens is when we take a closer look, now you start seeing some hair-like features here in this bend here, in this section of their pharynx. And you have that tight bend here. You can see what the white line is. That's how the liquids pass through. And when you get a closer look, you have a lot of hairs there. And even a closer look reveals that they have a filtering mechanism. And what it means is they're capable of filtering spores. I mean, 0.5 microns, I think, is the max, the minimum or max they can actually, you know, the max they can actually retain is a 0.5 microns. So they have all these filtering mechanisms that allows them to filter all small, bigger particles, 0.5 or larger. Now, what happens is, if you recall, they do trophallaxis. So whatever they pick on the counter is not that one ant is gonna walk all the way back to the colony several feet away or yards and bring it back to the colony. That means that ant is gonna share it with the next ant, with the next and the next. And that food is being filtered multiple times before it reaches the colony and before it reaches actually the queen in the colony. So to demonstrate this in a different way, if you look at this, I always tell everybody, you know, queens are your bullseye. That's your target. and the queen is sitting there in the colony, queen or queens, could be multiple, laying eggs all day, getting fed by all these ants. Now let's pretend each one little black dot here, let's pretend is one ant. And these queen or queens are surrounded by these nurses taking care of feeding the queen and so on. Inside the colony, you also have all these guys. They're the fourth instar larvae. You're gonna have a lot of those because those, remember, those are important in the colony. Surrounded by more ants, they're nurses. You're also gonna have the youngsters in the family. You're gonna have the first, second, and third instar larvae. Surrounded by more ants that they take care of the entire colony. There's also a group of ants and also workers that they live inside the colony. And for the most part, what they try to do is maintain the galleries, protecting the colony, and they have different functions within the colony. But then you also have another ring, and this is what I call out, these are the guys, the foragers that venture out looking for food. Now, what is interesting is that these are the oldest members of the colony. So the oldest member of the colony, they get sent out looking, searching for food. And it's hard to imagine, you know, but that's what another mechanism they have for survivorship. I'll send the oldest guys out, something happens to them, I'm sorry, but I'm gonna make sure I keep the strong and young folks protected, and that's what they do. Now, one of the things they do is when the foragers go into the Mrs. Jones kitchen, for example, and they pick that liquid. Again, we talk about that first tiny dot there is your first ant, pick up this liquid and then moves and transfers to the next one, then to the next one, and until it reaches inside the colony, the first, second, and third instar larva. And then the solids, and these are like, you know, pieces of food. Somebody forgot a pancake on the table, and now ants are going at it. Somebody put a solid base somewhere in a wall void, and now ants are picking these up. So again, these are picked up by the first few ants, the foragers. They chopped into smaller pieces, usually, not all the time, but usually. And they're passing on from one individual to the next until it reaches the fourth instar larva, which is the food processor of the colony. So these guys will take all these solids and they will digest it, as I explained with the picture. Once all this food is digested, fed back to the queen, as we mentioned, and to the youngsters. The meconium, don't forget the meconium piece. That piece is important because it's going to increase egg production. So high nutritional value there. And the solid component is going to be redistributed with the fourth instar larva again, to be digested and to be recycled within the colony. Now, why am I telling you all these things? And this is probably one of the most important pieces here today is because based on this, and if I was in person with you, I would ask you, based on all the information I'm giving you today, how long should I tell Mrs. Jones, we put out some bait at your house, and now you will have to wait X number of days. How many days should that be? And usually I get a lot of different answers. And this is my advice to you. It all depends on the species. It all depends on the size of the colony. But I would say that it's safe to say to at least wait 3 days. Don't tell Mrs. Jones you're not gonna have ant problems anymore after this afternoon because I just came and put out some bait. You know for a fact that if you put out bait, you need to tell Mrs. Jones, expect to see more ants because they need to come and get it and take it back to the nest. At least wait 3 days. When I did some of my visits to customers in the field, I waited 4, sometimes 5 days. And I would tell them, I'm gonna come back and check and see how things are going, but expect this is an ongoing situation, not a one-time visit. Many times, because the size of the colony or because you put enough food out or bait or product, you could get it resolved, but it's not safe to say that happens all the time. Remember, each customer is different, each account is different. Now, the other question I have also to ask you when I show this slide is, remember your bullseye, your objective here is to control that queen or queens. And we know already that takes some time to get there, the product, whether you're using a solid or a liquid. So one of the things I do want to say is, what are the chances, by the way, the foragers, I'm going to talk about the forages a little bit here, to increase the chances of getting to that bull's eye, you will have to use a strategy here. And one thing I do want to point out again is the foragers in most of the ant colonies, they could be from 10 to 20% of the colony will be foragers forming this ring that ventures outside the colony. So let's say it's your luckiest day ever in your life. You won the lottery and you were able to kill 100% all the foragers at Mrs. Jones' house. The question I have for you is, what do you think is going to happen next? Remember, you have your bullseye. It's an egg making machine. That's all she does. So those rings, I guarantee it that it will not be long before all of those rings are replaced. So even if you're the luckiest guy on earth and kill them all, that outer ring, the foragers, will be replaced. And guess what? You're going to be getting that call back in 3 days or less, depending on the species, depending on the size of the colony. So make sure, this is why it's so important that we don't use repellent quick kill products. You want, with social insects, in this case ants, you want them to work slow. You want them to allow for transfer effect. You don't want to kill those first few ants that pick up the bait from the counter. So you gotta be thinking about all these strategies when you're dealing with ants and other social insects as well. But in this case, ants specifically. So I hope that was useful. I hope you got some ideas on how the food moves inside the colony, because it's important and it's something that will help you in the future determining the best tools to use. I do want to mention something else. Pest control starts with that first phone call to your office. Whether you're a CSR or the company owner or the technician who gets that call, that very moment is when pest control starts. And I'm going to show you why. Usually you get this call. I have lots of ants in my kitchen. They are everywhere, all over the place. When can you come out? These are the things you're going to first hear on the phone. And you guys know that. The next thing is going to happen is, now you have your CSR or whoever took that phone call. Now make sure you ask the right questions to the homeowner. And now I'm not telling you to keep the homeowner for an hour talking with you on the phone, because you know that's not going to happen in most cases. Some cases you will get those, but most cases they want to be quick. They want you to come out, but you can ask real quick, how bad is it? You know, you can ask some of these questions, because I can tell you how customers, they see two ants and they're calling you and freaking out. You have other customers, they have hundreds of ants and they're just sitting in the living room drinking beer, no problem. So make sure you ask these right questions. How bad is it? Are they stinging? Where are they? In collective specific details, for example, one of the things I always like to do is, Mrs. Jones, when I'm still on the phone, are you going to be there tomorrow or when we schedule the service? Are chances that you're going to be there, or is there going to be somebody else? If she or he says, no, I'm not going to be there, make sure you collect more details. Like, can you put a sticky note where the ants were coming from? Can you collect, are they small? Are they, and I'm not talking about measuring in millimeters. Are they tiny, small, medium, large, color, two colors, one color? Are they trailing or scattered? Why do I need to know if they're scattered? I know if they're scattered, they might be, looking for food. What happens once they find the food, they start trailing. But once they start trailing, I got some important information. One is I can trail them back and see where they're coming from. exactly where most likely the nest is located, but also I can now tell what they're feeding on. Are they feeding on sweets? Are they feeding on proteins? Because depending on the season and the ant species, they will switch. And that, knowing that information, then I can select the right bait product or the right strategy. What time of the day are they coming out? Are they coming out at night? You know, you got like carpenter ants, they will come out at night. So you have to know all these things. Where are they feeding on? We already touched on that. And are there any elderly in the household? Are there children that may be allergic to some of these reactions? Or, you know, children, they drop food. So it increases the chances because now you're competing against all these food sources scattered in the house. And, you know, pets, just to make sure that the pet is not getting to the bait. So those are the things you definitely need to ask. Now it's time for the TSR or whoever took that phone call to actually communicate. Communication is key. Communicate to that technician. One thing I do want to point out, try to send always the same technician. This is account ownership. I don't know how many times I've been in situations where, oh yeah, we send four technicians. When I looked at the history of the account, it's four different technicians. And they don't know what they did before. So they're guessing. And for the most part, they are doing all the same. So they're not solving any issues there. So make sure you send the same person. CSR or whoever took the phone call need to provide all the details in writing. And then when you schedule the visit, keep these things in mind. These are trouble. Like if you have the 24 hour response time, for many of our customers out there, this is a must do, respond within 24 hours. I would say more importantly than the 24 hours is making sure that the person that saw the problem is there. Also making sure that if the ants are active in the afternoon because it's warm and nice, and you schedule an early appointment next morning, chances are you're not gonna see a single ant. Also, watch out for that robot tech. You know what a robot tech is? And I know you've seen some of those, is when they go grab the most repellent quick kill product they can grab in their truck, because most likely they already have that in their BNG, and they go out around the baseboard and they come back to their truck and they're done. So that's a robot tech with a 5-minute visit. And if you do all of these, you better start scheduling that call back, because I know it's gonna happen. So those are things to keep in mind when you're dealing with ants. It's not easy, like I said, and every situation is different. Now the big day is here. Now you show up at customer's home. You knock on that door. You know, one thing is that same person that reported the problem there? Because if it is, you better be asking all the same questions again. Communicate, ask all these questions, take notes. Once all information is collected, then you have to make sure you do a thorough inspection, analyze all the variables, set the right expectations with the homeowner, educate the customer and get them involved. So make sure you explain how things are gonna play out and what expectations, and maybe there's opportunity that you're gonna see a lot of ants next morning or next day, and making sure you set the expectations that I'm gonna have to go back and follow up and see if I need to put out more bait, or if I need to change the bait, or if I need to change the strategy. So all these things are super important when we're doing pest control. Now, some of the variables we can talk about, you know, what plants are around the homes, trees, big trees touching the roof of the house, touching the siding of the home. What food is available? I mean, if you got a lot of plants, a lot of roses and hibiscus, you know there's gonna be probably aphids, and you know ants love aphids. So other arthropods, that links into that. Not only aphids, but also other arthropods that they will feed on. There are other things too, but of course climate is related to season changes. And of course, depending on the life cycle, they're gonna have different needs. Certain times of the year, they're gonna increase the sugar consumption to get that quick energy. Some times of the year, they're gonna switch to oils, you know, fats and proteins that they need. But then when you look at the homeowner, make sure you point out those conducive conditions. Make sure you educate the homeowner. We talk about it. And when it comes to you guys, make sure that communication between the technician and the CSR, it's important. And now we're going to focus on the protocols. That's why I have protocols highlighted here. And I'm going to share some products and some ideas on how, when to use these, each one of these. I know there's a lot of information, but I think the best part on how to apply these and how to use it is coming up pretty quick here. I'm not going to cover some of these because I know that Scott already covered some of these. The foundation for any superior perimeter pest control, I would say, is Termidor. Alpine gives you all that flexibility. You have Fendona as a long-lasting product. Microcap, by the way, it is a repellent. You have on the bullpen, these are when you need specific troubleshooting, when you want to do something specifically, you have all these other products waiting for you to be used in the bullpen. You have Termidor foam, for example, Alpine foam. All those foaming products are great because they expand inside wall voids. You have pressurized products, all the PT brands like Fendona, for example, another repellent, but you also have some non-repellent products. And then we have a new kid in the block, I like to call it, because PT Vendera pressurized is coming out this summer. So stay tuned for more information. I would say reach out to your sales reps because you're gonna learn a lot about these exciting new mode of action. It's a new AI called broflanolide. So stay tuned because this is actually a brand new IRAC group 30. And it's gonna be super exciting to have these new product. As baits, we're all familiar with what we use in the past, Advanced. There's Mother Earth 2, Siesta Faran baits. A new kid in the block is coming soon. We don't know yet, but it's coming. Vedira granular and bait, also broflanolide. And there's also other formulations too, like dusts. So if you look at this, I have a dilutables, I have foam pressurized baits and dust formulations. And I'll show you now how to use and when to use each one of those. When we talk about ant control, we have to look at the big picture. Think of you're on top of the house, you're a drone flying above on top of the house. And then you have to look at, you know, what are the habitats and microhabitats that I have, the niche that a certain ant population occupies is usually what they where they get their food and water and shelter, nesting sites and all that. So when you look at a house, there could be many hiding places for these, for ants and for any other pests. So let's break that down. I like thinking of rings of protection and I like this approach. One thing I do wanna point out, guys, I'm not asking you today to have 20 rings of protection. So this has to be practical, okay? I'm just giving you this as examples of things you could do to get better control of ants. The outer ring, it's away from the house. Then you have the ring number 2, usually around the perimeter of the house. And ring number 3 is what I call inside the home. And you have to make sure the products you're using are labeled for each of these sites. Because as you know, some of the products you cannot use indoors. Now, when we look at these, the outermost ring, I'm thinking about all the shrubs, trees, landscape, grass, and all those areas. These are some of the choices that you could potentially use around the structure. And I'm gonna go to the next level, which is ring 2. Now I'm coming closer to the home. And these are like the lines, the driveway lines, the sidewalks, the flower beds. Now I'm getting closer to the house. Also in ring 2, by the way, these are some of the options you could use here, but specifically Termidor, these are the only sites where you could use Termidor. And I say the only is the vast majority of people don't even know the Termidor can be used under the eaves and don't even know it can be used around windows and doors outside. And that's important to note. So keep in mind that whatever products you're using, in this case, Termidor, they're not just labeled for termites and ants. There's a lot of different other pests that you will be controlling with these products. And think along the lines that many of these pests are actually a food source to ants. So think of, about all the things you can do with the products and the tools we have. Now, when we look inside, now we're looking inside the home, there's aerosols, there's granular baits, there's dilutables, there's dusts, products, and things like that that you could definitely use inside a home. So let's jump into some ideas here. And I'm gonna break these down because again, I cannot tell you a single protocol that will work for every situation. Every situation is different. And I'm gonna share that in a second. For example, this is what I call a curative or reactive control. And this is when I have high-end activity inside, outside, probably colony or colonies are already established in the structure. It could be inhabitants of a world void, could be under the carpet, it could be somewhere else in a potted plant, whatever inside the house. These are usually your problem accounts. These are the accounts that you can get rid of ants. Whatever you do, they still have ants. And most of the time, these are first-time services or one-time services. Imagine doing a one-time services for ant control. I hope you're not offering any guarantees there, but imagine all these things that takes place here. One of the things I do want to say is that sometimes you acquired an account that belonged to another PMP. And you don't know the history. You don't know what has been done in the past. Another way, another opportunity to communicate with the homeowners and ask them, what have you seen they've done in the past? Just walk through the entire process again, like if they never had pest control, because they may reveal some really good, important information. So for this particular home, there's ants everywhere. I will focus on non-repellents and products that are non-repellents, and most importantly, focus on products that has transfer effect. So I'm gonna break that down for you. Some of these products are non-repellents. Some of the AIs are non-repellents. Some of these will have genuine transfer effect and all of that. And these are the type of products I want you to use. For example, outside, you could use baits. And I also included the new product there that is coming soon, but you can use any of the granular baits, or you can use a dilutable product like Alpine WG, for example. Now, around the perimeter of the structure, this is an area that you normally get a lot of high traffic because you're gonna have ants either searching for food and water near the house, or they're gonna try to venture out searching for food and water if they don't have it inside the house. So this is a great spot to always apply Termidor SC, 1 foot up, 1 foot out, 2 to 4 times a year. And I do wanna point out that California has different restrictions. So make sure you read and follow those label directions. But then inside, now we've got the baits outside, we got Termidor on the high traffic areas. Now let's move inside. Inside, you can also use some of the products like Alpine, you can use Phantom, you can use Angel baits or granular baits. You can use foam, either Alpine or Termidor inside wall voids to get that control. When you look at this, again, non-repellent products, chances of increasing the transfer effect will pay off in the long run. Now, when we have a situation where you have a proactive control, and I hope that majority of your customers probably is gonna fall in this category, meaning there's a lot of high-end activity, mostly outside, still within the property lines, but several colonies might be present in the yard, somewhere in the property. And again, I hope these are the majority of the customers. So these are the customers that you want to keep ants away from the house, not you don't want to attract the ants to the house. And this is where I change things a little bit. On the outer ring, again, it's important to use all those baits. Now you're using the baits away from the house. And there's a strategy with that. You could also use dilutable products that I want to make sure that the AIs are non-repellents and things like that. So you want to use those products as well, because again, you cannot mix repellents with baits. You guys know that part. you can now use Termidor in the ring number two, the perimeter. You can use Termidor, something like Termidor. But also you can use products like PT Fendona, which is a repellent. You can use it in cracks and crevices around the structure. So if you think about it, you have the high traffic areas with a non-repellent, but now any openings, any entry points to the house, I'm hitting those with some repellent products. Could be aerosols for cracks and crevices, right? I'm putting the baits out in the yard, but now what I do inside is I can use more repellent products on inside the wall voids. You can use cracks and crevices like aerosols, things like that. You can also dust wall voids to lay a light coat of dust inside the wall voids, or I can use Fendona, which is a repellent. There's also, you know, the possibilities of using non-repellent, but the idea here is to create some repellency in the house around the structure, creating that high traffic zone with Termidor, which is a non-repellent. So anything getting away from the house will cross that, and then having the baits outside kind of attracting things away from the house. And that's a good strategy. Again, when you look at these examples, I'm not telling you to use all of these products. I'm telling you to pick and choose one or two or maybe three products that you can start with. There's chances that you may need to change your strategies, change the products and switch things around. But the whole idea is you pull those ants away from the structure. And then when you have a preventative control, now, when I look at preventative is, I know these neighborhoods are inundated with ants. And I see every time I go there and I look around to do an inspection, I can see ants trailing from Mrs. Smith's house next door. So what would you do? The first thing I would do is grab a business card and knock next door and say, Mrs. Smith, I'm here doing the pest control service for Mrs. Jones. And I happen to run into some ant activity that it seems to be coming from your house. If you ever need any, if you ever have any problems or have any questions, please give me a call. You leave the card there. Chances are you're going to get a new customer. And when you look at this situation, when most of the ant activity now it's outside the property lines, it could be a house that is facing a green belt. It could be a house that is in a high pressure area, or you could have neighbors that never have pest control. So it could be multiple situations. The chances of being in this situation is that you most likely at some point will get ants invading the property. Now, in this case, I want to move that repellent ring to the outer ring. That's why I'm using Fendona CS in this case. That's why I want to use now granular insecticides, non-bait. These are the parathroids, granular formulations. These are repellents. You can scatter them outside on the outer ring. You could also use products like Alpine, which is a good choice too. But I would try to move that outer ring now becoming my repellency zone area. Now, when I looked at around the perimeter of the structure, now we're talking about same Termidor. I want to have my 2 to 4 times a year Termidor around that high traffic areas. Then you can use something like PT Fendona pressurized for cracks and crevices. You can use Vadira, a new kit in the block that will be coming this year. So you can also use that. Now, on the inside, what would I do? Probably nothing. At this point in time, I don't have ants on the inside. I would probably do an inspection, make sure Mrs. Jones is having no problems. If needed, I can treat crack and crevices, but the applications in the inside of the house would be very, very limited to none. So I hope all this information, I know it's a lot of information, but I want to close it now with before I close it, I do want to reinforce again, I'm giving you ideas. I'm giving you all the tools we have at hand, or not all, but you know, good number of products and tools to use. Use these smart, not asking you to use all of them. I don't want you to use all of these in one account because it's going to be cost prohibited. But make sure you understand the main properties of the product, use different formulations for what you want to do. Make sure you understand which are repellents, which are not, which has transfer effect, and those things. And remember, for social insects, and specifically ants, the slower the product works, the better, right? So that's important to understand. With that, I think I'm going to close saying, always make sure you read and follow the label directions. This is super important that you guys do this part. And it's the law. And remember, there's products you can use indoors, others you cannot use indoors, and vice versa. So make sure that you know the label before you apply that product, use that product. So with that, I would like to thank you all for being here today. Hopefully you had the opportunity to learn something new about ants. Maybe not, maybe it was a refresher, but I hope you got something with you to take back and to apply and use it. So with that, I'm gonna pass it on to Scott. Scott, and see if we have any questions in the chat, in the group.
Yeah, we do. Thank you, Dr. Freder. Great information. I really appreciate everybody staying and learning and listening for a bit. One question I'll address just right off the bat. Dory, thank you for the feedback and good reminder. We are sending the recording out. So if you have some technicians or teammates who weren't able to join and you're thinking, wow, I really wish, you know, they could hear this, good news, we'll send out the recording so that you have that. And also you'll see the winners of the drawing that was announced at the beginning will be included in that same message. So we'll check that one off from the housekeeping side, and I'll go to a couple of the tech questions, Fred, or for you. The first is Terminator SC, how is it on controlling paper wasp?
So yeah, as a matter of fact, as you notice, it's on the label. So we have data that was submitted to EPA when we registered that use a long time ago. Can't remember the year now, but yes, it's really, it's amazing how people use Terminator just for termite control and ant control. I can tell you it does a great job at controlling wasps, and it does a great job actually at controlling spiders. So if you guys haven't used that product this way, make sure you follow the label on how to apply it around the house, because that's important. But as I noted before, let me show you this. See if I can share it again. Can you guys see the desktop right now? I can share this and see if
Yes, we can see your desktop, and now we see the three rings of protection.
Okay. Yeah. So let's see if I can get it. Okay. So these are the pests listed on the Terminator label. And as you can see, we have a different variety of ant species, but also you got paper wasp, yellow jackets, and it does an awesome job. I can assure you that with spiders. So hope that answered the question there about the controlling wasp and I think some other species of ants too.
And that's a good segue to the next question, Fredder. Terminator labeling for ant control. So the question was, is it labeled for all ants, just some ants? Can you speak to the ant control label for Terminator?
Yeah, you can see it here, everyone. You can see it here on the screen. So we got acrobat ants, Argentine big-headed ant, carpenter crazy, odorous pavement, feral ant, thief ants. So we got not all, but many of the species there on the label. So I hope that answers, but that's all. Yeah, all we have on that label.
Perfect. And as you mentioned, this is a screenshot directly from the specimen label where that is called out. So
that's right.
The next question that I'll get to is, Lee mentioned he's in Florida and 80% ghost ant issues he called out. He's wondering if you have tips on your strategy, sprays versus baits, et cetera. Can you speak a bit to ghost ants in particular, Fredder?
So this is in Florida. One of the things here is when you're dealing with different species of ants, you have to know a little bit more about their biology and a little bit more about control strategies. Like some of these ants will definitely prefer sweets. And, but again, they, depending on the time of the year, they might have different requirements. So one strategy that I did not mention, even if you go, let's say you go into the house without knowing what type of ants you're dealing with, this is a practice that I commonly use just so I know what type of food they're taking. And what I would do is I go into a house and I would know the, you know, if a certain product contains sugars or proteins or a combination sometimes contains fats and oils. And what I would do is I would do a little bit, just a tiny drop, the size of this pen probably, the size of these, I would do a tiny drop and I will do one next to each other. And I will do other things in the house. By the time I come back, I can check and see at that time, real life, what kind of bait, what kind of product they're taking in at that time, because this could easily change. And I will go with that strategy first. If I know these ants are taking sweets right now, I will go that. If they're taking something else, I will go with that strategy. Keep in mind that it's always good practice to come back a few days later and check, are there any ants? Have they moved to a different place? Are they taking some other type of food at the time? And I might need to do a test again. But yeah, that's a good practice, and not only for ghost ants, but for any other ants out there, kind of choosing what they might take at that moment, at that time. So I hope that helped a little bit. Again, every situation is different. And every species and every location is different, right? So I hope that helps a little bit on identifying the bait, the best choice of bait at that time.
Yeah, and we'll kind of answer these. I'll try to segment them out a bit by topic. So staying on the topic of Termidor labeling. So Lee had also asked that he would prefer to use Termidor for spiders on pool cages, but since it's not allowed per the label, do you have any recommendations for control methods or alternative products?
Yeah, definitely. When you're dealing with the spiders, they're kind of tricky depending on the species as well. I like to stick, when it comes to spider, with long-lasting products. It could be microcap products. So Fendona, it will be a great choice for that. Those microcaps are going to stick on those surfaces. That would probably be my number one choice there. And of course, Termidor, but if you cannot use Termidor where you are in this situation, I would definitely use Fendona. You could also use some aerosols in cracks and crevices to make sure you're getting it there. Sometimes they nest in the block walls. Also, if there's shrubbery, I would try to cut that back, keep some distance there. Spray some residual product around that part of the property. Also, when it comes to spiders, and now I'm giving you an IPM kind of approach with what I'm saying, and not just the chemical, the product itself, but also keep an eye on lights, especially if lights are kept, like landscaping lights are kept on during the nighttime. You know it's going to attract moth and other insects to it. And you know the spiders will be around trying to get to those sprayed items too. So using a general insecticide such as Fendona CS will control spiders, will control their food source as well. And try to use those in areas where definitely you cannot use Termidor. But if you can around the structure, you could definitely use Termidor.
Great. And Frutter, a question also came in. When did Termidor get this broad pest label? So I know we've had different timings on label enhancements for, applications per year or pest. Some of these date back, I believe, to maybe even 2010 or earlier. But can you give maybe a bit of history on the evolution of the Termidor label?
That's a very good question. Actually, I don't remember on top of my head now. I know ants were added in 2002, I believe. So I have to look at the chronologically when the general pass was added to it. I can't remember now, but I can't remember.
Okay, long time ago. But as mentioned, there's been different iterations and enhancements that we've worked on. So another question, again, just staying on the topic of Terminator labeling. We have one question in Florida. Because it is a site state, can you use Terminator on an ant that is not on the label?
Yeah, so that's one of the problems we commonly encounter. So that's something else I have to keep in mind. So make sure that, you know, you have to definitely list the species are on the label, right? But in a situation where the use site is on the label, as long as you're not listing something that is not there, you can use the product there, and that would not be a problem at all. But the key point there is, as long as you don't list something that it will not be covered on the label, in the use site, the site is, there will be no problem. You could definitely do that.
Okay, let me go back up. Veronique had asked a question about Vidira, the upcoming products you mentioned. So, and this one, I don't know if we can cover today or not. She's asking what the active ingredient is. Is that something that we can talk through here, or is that forthcoming?
Yeah, so we can briefly talk about it. It's broflanolide. So it works on the GABA-gated chloride channels. It's allosteric modulator. So it acts similar to fipronil, but not the same. And it's a new IRAC group, and the Insecticide Resistance Action Committee group. There's three products there now. But yeah, a new group was created for these chemistries. And I can tell you that some of the products we talked about today, they are having a long residual, fast knockdown in some of those, like a PT Vidira pressurized. So there's going to be a lot of new information coming in the near future. But yeah, this is exciting to have a new, completely brand new mode of action, new product called Brofanolide.
Okay, we have just a couple more here. There was a question on treatment strategy, and the one that you were discussing, is there any concern about using a repellent inside the home and pushing the pests further into the home or to a different area of the home, as opposed to pushing them to the exterior?
So yeah, you gotta be careful. If you have a house that has already a lot of ants on the inside, I don't recommend using repellent products. So I know that the house I inspected, the homeowners historically never had any ant problems, and I start noticing ant activity on the outside, that's when I take measurements, like creating some sort of barrier in the house. So think along the lines, if you have ant activity and then you start applying non-repellents and baits inside the home, you know, you're going to attract ants inside the structure, and that's a part that I want to avoid. So in those situations where ants are mostly outside, I can use dust in the wall voids. I can use repellents like Fendona CS. I can use repellents like some of the aerosol products for cracks and crevices. And the whole idea is I want to prevent the ants from coming in. I want to prevent the ants from nesting inside the wall voids or establishing themselves inside the wall voids. Once they're inside, then I have to switch completely my strategy, as I mentioned, because I don't want to be splitting these colonies and creating a bigger problem, especially if we're dealing with Argentina ants and other ants too. But yeah, that's a good question.
And the last two here, Roberto, back to the Terminator and paper wasp situation. So I'll maybe combine these a bit. But once wasps come in contact with Terminator and they land on the nest, does it transfer as a bait? And then the second part is the best way to apply Terminator on a second story structure. And do we have any data that supports paper wasp pressure in Terminator? So, Fred, if you could maybe speak to a couple of those.
Yeah, so I don't recall if there's been any studies done in the transfer to other nest mates, specifically for wasps. I don't know if there's been any studies along those lines. I know it's a challenge to actually get a Thermidor on the second story home like the one I showed. Definitely you want to watch out where the product is going. And for the most part, you know, most PMPs will do it on the first floor. But if there's nests up above, my recommendation is to knock those down and actually treat those areas with Thermidor, which you would need to get a ladder to get up there and make sure you treat it without getting drifted into other places. So it is a challenge when you have tall houses that we have here in town in Raleigh. I'm Raleigh now, and I've seen that being a challenge. But I think the UCR group at some point was looking at the transferability of some products for wasp control, but I don't recall if it's ever been published. So I'm gonna have to look it up because I'm not 100% sure.
All right, thank you. And then we have an additional question here from Lee. He's asking if Thermidor is allowed above 3 foot from the ground, like second floors.
Yeah, right now it is. Don't know what's gonna happen in the future, I have to admit that, but right now it's always been allowed to do that type of applications. What you're referring to, the 3 feet above ground, is usually for parathroid, for perimeter applications, for band applications. But yeah, you could definitely use Thermidor around windows and under the eaves. Places are protected from the rain. One thing I do want to point out, as many of you know, is treating where there's a concrete pad and patios and things like that. You have to make sure that the areas are well protected from the rain.
Yeah, it's, you know, honestly, I think this is just a great reminder for all of us that the Thermidor label, you know, when you get a chance, go to CDMS or pull out a label and review. A lot of us remember the 1 foot up, 1 foot out, you know, Thermidor, ants and termites twice a year. But again, a lot's changed, right? We talked about the additional pest species, you know, spiders, wasps, a lot of these different pests, different application timings now based on rate. And then just like you talked about, Dr. Frater, you know, windows, doors, a lot of these application sites that are in the label and maybe just aren't as well known. So I would encourage everyone, you know, just take a second look and see maybe some of the opportunities there in the label that we've, that we've been able to get that maybe you've been missing out on. So I see, Keith, I see that you have your hand raised. Is there a question? If not, it may have been an accident, but if so, you just need to unmute and or feel free to ask the question in the chat. But I did want to just make sure we address it if you had a question.
Yeah, I can see a question there, Scott, about using Thermidor on the Webster head is not allowed. So if you read the label, does not call for that type of use. I know some people have been promoting even using parathroids and things like that. Make sure that use is well described on the label. So that's what I would do. And I know there's a lot of things to the label. So if you need more information about all the label related things, pull out the label like Scott said, but also you have the ability to reach out to our sales folks. Our sales reps are very knowledgeable about our products. And even the tech service reps in the field, but reach out to us. That's what I'm saying. If you're in doubt and if you need training, we'll be there to provide that support, that anything you need.
And with that, I think we've answered all the questions. There was one more that came through. It was asking about a drawing. I wasn't exactly sure. I think they're referring to the prize drawing. So again, just to mention, after we wrap up here, we are going to do a random drawing of the attendees. And then the results will be emailed along with this presentation. So Won't be announced on this call, but it will be coming very shortly. And again, there'll be three prizes, one being a backpack sprayer and two being Yeti Tumblr. So just keep an eye on your email for the presentation and the announcement of who won that. I believe that's what that was referring to. Okay. So with that, I believe we're almost at time. I just want to say again, thank you everybody for taking time out. Thank you, Dr. Fretter, for all the great information. As you mentioned, a great plug for our teams. Feel free, if you think of anything else, if you're reading the labels or going back through the presentation, reach out to our sales team, your tech rep, et cetera. Let us know how we can help. And again, check your email for the results of the drawing and the presentation if you have some teammates that you would like to see this. So again, we're really excited about our promotion that's going on. If you see a product that was mentioned that you want to purchase at a discount, this is a great time through April to do that. And also be on the lookout for more Perimeter Pro webinars from BASF. We're going to continue to send out more invites and have more of these type of webinars on different topics. So with that, I will close out and say again, thank you. And I hope you have a great rest of your week, and please be safe.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Scott.